Okay, so hi everybody, welcome to our webinar tonight that focuses on dealing with university worries. My name's Chelsea and I'm your host tonight, and I'm joined by Bobby, Annette, Leslie and Chris. These guys are from our future U team here at UCEN Manchester. So please could I ask you all to introduce yourselves, tell us a bit about yourself, and I'll go in alphabetical, so I'll start with Annette.
Fantastic, thanks Chelsea. Yeah, my name's Annette McCone and I'm the director for the disability team at UCEN Manchester. So essentially our role is about making sure that if you do have a declared disability, that we help you make a smooth transition to UCEN Manchester and make sure that you have the support in place throughout your studies leading to a successful graduation and hopefully employment.
Thank you very much. And B, so I'll go with Bobby next.
Thanks, Chelsea. My name is Bobby Sadbar. I'm from the Careers and Welfare team, and we are responsible for providing career guidance, support with making sure you're on the right course, graduate pathways, career planning. In addition, we also provide welfare advice and support with applications such as student finance, financial support, and any signposting that may be required for additional support from other teams.
Thanks, Bobby. And Chris, about yourself?
Hi, I'm Chris. I'm from the GM Higher team. So we help people progress into higher education and then give them support once they're in higher education as well. And I've got a background in careers and helping people to look about their future careers, get motivated, helping de-stress and have a great career in their future.
Well, thank you. And last but not least, Leslie.
Hi, I'm Leslie. I'm part of the library team. We're here to support you through with your studies, whether it's assignment writing, referencing, proofreading, how to do time management, how to prepare your dissertation, anything like that we can help with, all the academic side of the study skills. And we can do it one-to-one in group sessions and as many times as you want it throughout the year.
Lovely. Thank you that, everyone, for all your nice introductions there. So obviously going to university is a really exciting time for students. It's the beginning of a new chapter, it's the start of something new, but there are times when the stresses and pressures of uni can begin to, you know, potentially overwhelm or worry, or people might just start to just become a bit, you know, worried about some things, whether it's stress or just not knowing things really. But sometimes a lot of these things can be solved just by finding out, or just by learning a bit of information about what can be offered, or just a little bit of useful advice that they may not be aware of. So that's what tonight's all about, really. Just kind of hoping to share some information that you may not be aware of, and hopefully it might be able to help you. So I'm just going to start by saying, what are some of the common worries that you find students facing whilst at uni? So Bobby, am I all right to direct that at you?
Yeah, absolutely. So everyone's an individual. Everyone's going to be worried about very different types of things. So just to give you a general idea of things that most students worry about, it's assignments, projects. Going to higher education means you're going to have deadlines, a lot more independent study. Along with that means exam preparation, academic writing. It can be quite a leap from going to something like A-levels to higher education. So you find that, you know, in terms of like academic writing, there might be more higher standards that maybe you've not experienced before. From the social side, some people might struggle with fitting in, making friends. It's a new environment. Then in addition to that, you've got support needs and you're not sure how to address those support needs, who to go to for help. In addition to that, something that's very common nowadays, it's coping with stress, maybe mental health issues. And again, not knowing when to ask for help or who to ask for help. And that's just a handful of examples or typical examples that we find students are kind of coping with nowadays or need support with.
Thanks for that. So what can students do if they are struggling to keep up with their uni work? Chris, are you able to answer that one?
Definitely. The first thing you must do is ask for help. There is so much help in all the HEIs, and especially at UCEN. UCEN is a small university where there's loads of tutors, a big careers team, loads of support people out there. We've got Leslie from the library today here who offers like a range of different services. Ask for help. We also have like specialist workers as well. So if you're a carer or you've got disabilities or you got, you know, you're from a military family or something like that, we've got people who can give you specialized advice. So you always must ask for help.
Amazing, thank you. And has anybody else got any other tips that, you know, if a student is struggling to keep up with, if with their uni work, obviously ask for help. Anything from anybody else?
I think it's just being aware of the amount of resources that are out there. So as well as face-to-face and, you know, staff, we've got a whole heap of online resources. So for example, as part of Future U, we've got a whole host of sort of study skills. So you can have access to that now. You don't even need to wait until you're enrolled in UCEN Manchester. And what that begins to do is give you a flavour of, you know, specific study skills that we're talking about. So goal setting, time management, organisational skills, because that is a key difference from sort of school to college, is the expectation that you will be able to self-manage. There will be no one chasing you, you know, to hand in your work. So it's really important that you're, you know, you're self-motivated, that you're disciplined, and that you're organized. I think they're the sort of three top skills. So my advice would be, don't wait until you've started, you know, start to think about how you can get a head start. So familiarizing yourself with some of those study skills, online modules that are there. And it's not just our own university. I think if you look at Manchester University, for example, they've got a whole host of free resources about, you know, academic writing, what we mean by academic writing. And just getting ahead of the game can just make you feel that bit more like you're hitting the ground running, rather than, you know, just thinking about these things when you've got your first assignment. So that would be one of the top tips that I would share. And I think what GM Hire do really well is that, you know, sorry, Chris, but, you know, like summer schools and, you know, some of those sort of workshop sessions that happen even before you make that transition to university. So think about what's available at your own school, at your own college, at your own provider, and make the most of it. You know, it's fantastic that it's December and you're already thinking about this. So you've got a window of sort of 9 months to really sort of get up to, you know, upskilled in what it means to be a student at university and studying at that higher level. And I think one other thing that I would say, just based on my own experience when I made that sort of transition, is that when you're at school and or in your current learning environment, you might find that you're doing really well, that you're top of the class. And one thing that can happen when you go to university is that you might see that you're no longer right up at the top. And sometimes that dents your confidence. So just to reassure you, it shouldn't. It's just that there is that sort of step up to higher education. So if you feel that your grades isn't quite what you want it to be when you get that feedback, make sure you listen to that feedback and make sure you feed that forward into your assignments. But trying hard not to be sort of disillusioned or lose your confidence, and really sort of, as we've said throughout, ask for help, ask for that feedback to make sure that, you know, with the next assignment, you can get better.
I think as well, a lot of students, when they start, think it's only them that feel the way they feel. Yes. So they think, I don't know about academic writing, but everybody else does. They think everybody else knows everything that they don't know, and they're worried about asking questions about it. We believe firmly there's no such thing as a stupid question. We're here to help. And a lot of the worries that people have, we've dealt with time and time again, and we're so happy that people come to us and that we can support them with whatever it is they need, like the worries over academic writing, worries over organisational skills. We're here and you're not the only one, so don't be afraid to ask us, because we've seen these situations so many times, and the earlier we can help you, the better, really.
It just comes down to, again, obviously people not being aware, really. Obviously we see this, and you see this time and time again, because, you know, you'll meet like cohorts of students who, you know, are facing, you know, these challenges or these worries for the first time. But then it kind of happens, you know, because it's so normal, you know, it's so normal for people to feel this way because it's so new. And it just is like, it's new to someone, that doesn't know how to deal with it, because it's completely new to them. But it's just a completely normal thing for people to experience. And I think as soon as they speak to somebody about it and realize that it's normal, even that alone helps. Just sharing it, and, you know, but I think loads of really interesting points have been raised there, and especially it's about utilizing the resources that are available, and sometimes you don't realize how, you know, how good the resources are. Like, you know, just for instance, you know, like the library and, you know, the support that is offered there, and even all the other teams, you know, like for that all you guys offer, people sometimes just may not be aware of it because they might not have had to, you know, use them resources before. And then they've come to university where, you know, as Annette mentioned, there's a lot more self-directed study that is needed. You're not going to have your tutor saying, right, guys, you've got an hour now, you can sit down and do your studying. You've got to find that time yourself. So yeah. I think because of that, it kind of, you realise actually, you know, I do need to, you know, ask for help or find out about what resources are available.
Absolutely, Chelsea. And I think one of the things as well about timetables and how they look so different. So, you know, and one of the sort of, you might think that you're only in for sort of 2.5 days and you think you've got all this free time to maybe socialise, maybe work. But actually, the rule of thumb is for every hour that you're timetabled, you should be doing at least an hour of self-directed study. And then you'll see that that 2.5 days quickly becomes 5. And that's why you're a full-time student. But nobody really explicitly says that to you. It's just that kind of expectation that you'll know that that's not free time. That's when you should be, you know, getting on top of your reading lists and engaging with the texts and your assignments, your group work, all of those things that, you know, you have to do as a learner studying towards a degree.
I think time management is really important. Time management is.
Shares and how to get their resources and stuff. We're both talking at the same time. Sorry, I'm going to go first now.
Just because we're so excited.
You know, people Google and they've Googled all through school, and Google is good. You know, a lot of libraries say Google's awful, and then it's, you go on it and think, well, it's great, I found this and this and this, so the librarian knows nothing. But we spend so much money on really good resources that you can only access through the library website, and it's good for us to have research sessions with you to show you how to research this information. You can speak now, Chris.
Thank you. It's a really good point that you made, though, actually, so I'm glad that that you interrupted. I spoke first. But I was going to say about time management is so important. And one of the techniques that I teach students is about using the time management matrix, which is basically putting all your different tasks in one of four boxes based on the level of importance versus the level of urgency. So high or low importance, high or low urgency. So something that's very highly urgent or highly important, you kind of need to like do that now. That's when you've got a really short deadline, something that needs to get in the next couple of days, compared to something that's highly important but not as urgent. That's when you can kind of like make notes, do a little bit more research, write things out, discuss it in your study groups and stuff like that. So by putting your task into one of these four boxes helps you plan your week, your month, or your academic year. It's a great technique, a great tool to use.
Yeah, and I think that just prepares you for life, doesn't it? And that's a sort of life skill that you'll take into employment, something that I should use more often.
I think we all could do that.
And I mean, yeah, that's the one of, like, there's loads of good ideas like that. You know, you've things like even forming a study group, or, you know, just having that motivation, or just getting a few of your mates from class and being like, right, yeah, we finish a half day today, but let's make the rest of the afternoon, let's stay for a couple of hours together. And even just being proactive and doing something like that, it can make it a bit more enjoyable as well, because you're with people and you're able to bounce off ideas. Just fun. It's just small things like that that really do make a difference. And I think the earlier you start doing that and get used to it and make it become part of, you know, how you learn, you know, the better it will be in the long run.
I think what's really exciting about the new build in our city centre campus for UCEN Manchester students is the amount of space that's going to be available for students to work both individually in groups, and then obviously go for a drink, because, you know, we've got the student union bar. So it's getting that balance, and I think that's the kind of key takeaway here, is that striking that balance. But I think, like, the new build, as I said, is there's got going to be lots of opportunities for you to do that lone working plus that group activity, which is really important, and of course the socializing.
Yes, definitely.
And in the libraries, we'd like it, we positively enforce that you're not just there to work academically in the library. Go in and read a book, sit and do some colouring, do something nice. It isn't, your well-being is a whole thing. It's not just about you need to do some work. It's about you as a person and feeling fulfilled and feeling happy as well when you're doing your course. And that's something we all support, is your well-being.
And as well, just another one about the library. Actually, I remember when I was at university, I moved out in my first year, but in my second and third, I was staying at home. And I lived at home with my mum and didn't have much study room. And I ended up going to Manchester Central Library. Mm-hmm. Each day I went and sat in that massive circular room, a beautiful room it is. I went and sat in there, mm. and I did study, and it was kind of one of the libraries that was, you know, complete silence, and it was very strict in there. And it's probably, you know, it might have been better if I went onto the campus library, but it was quite far from where I lived, but I just went there for convenience. But I, even just getting out of my house was just a good help, because it weren't just, you know, the fact that I was going to sit in the library all day, I was getting out into town, I was walking to the library, and I was, you know, then sitting down in a different environment to where I'd been. You know, it wasn't necessarily uni, it wasn't at home, it was just something different. And then I went back home, and it sort of like was almost like I was going out, and it gave me a bit more purpose, because I had this certain amount of time that I was there for. I needed to get some stuff done, and then I went back home.
Yeah,
so even just things like that.
And the good thing about the new build is we're going to have flexible learning spaces. So you might prefer to work in a group, you might prefer to work where it's noisy, you might prefer total silence, but we can help everybody have the environment that they want to study, because we all have different ways, don't we?
Yeah, and I think that's the key, isn't it, Leslie, that we all study in different ways, and, you know, try not to be influenced by others, you know, stick to what you know works for you, and have clear boundaries around that, because it's easy to kind of think, oh, well, I can study in a group, or I can study with music, you know, and it's really important that you stick to, you know, you're tried and tested, because they've got you this far.
Librarians are great as well. I was doing a leadership qualification last year, and I went into UCEN Library, got all like the project management books, got all the leadership books, got all the management theories and stuff like that. And the librarian started talking to me about this course and saying, like, what is it you're writing about? And explain like the assignment project. And she said, right, you don't need those books, you need these three books. And the amount of knowledge and expertise the librarians have, and they gave me the right books so I could get the right quotes and the right information, and got like a really good mark on that assignment. So definitely like ask for help from all the support.
You're welcome.
It just goes to show again, comes back to just, you know, asking people and speaking, and, you know, not always just resorting to like Google or something like that. Okay, so I'm just going to move us along. So the next question is, what are the key things that students need to think about when preparing for an exam? Leslie, are you able to maybe answer a bit on that?
I think it's preparation. You need to think about what questions there are, always look at past papers. And you know this, you've been to the, your sessions, your lectures, you do know it. Have a look at your notes, stay calm. Everybody is anxious in an exam. It's not, oh, I'm so stressed, I suffer from stress. This is a stressful situation. Stay calm, be prepared. And obviously don't go out the night before, is a very small tip, just a slight one, but it's all about however you feel comfortable revising as well. Some people like mind maps, some people like to write everything down, some people like to read it continually or condense their notes, but find what works best for you. Again, it's a very individual thing.
Yeah, and I think part of that is if you're a student that has a disability, learning disability, and you were used to having exam access arrangements at school, just to be mindful that they won't necessarily carry over into your university exams. So it's really important that you talk to your course tutor about that and any sort of extensions that can be agreed. But just to, you know, to really sort of be honest and upfront from the beginning that it's not like it was at school. So it's really important that you understand what that looks like for you. Just as Leslie says, it's an up to the individual and what that looks like for your degree programme.
I was running a workshop today, actually, as well as doing careers advice, I do hypnotherapy and help people overcome phobias and fears. And I was doing a workshop at UCEN on this today. And one of the things we talked about was what you focus on, you feel. So if you focus on like a big spider and you're scared of spiders, you'll feel that anxiety inside of you. But it's the same with exams as well. If you focus on being like anxious and being nervous and being worried, you'll feel that anxiety and worry inside yourself. But if you can change your perspective, change your mindset and see yourself being more positive, see yourself answering those questions, using those months of research that you've been doing during your course, if you see yourself as someone who's going to be successful, you'll feel more successful inside yourself, and it becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. If I think I'm going to fail, I'll naturally do things that will make me fail. If I think I'm going to be successful, then I'll actually do things at a subconscious level that makes me be more successful. So have a positive mindset when you go into exams and when you're writing your assignments. It makes a massive difference.
It's a really interesting tip there, Chris. Thanks for that. So yeah, thanks all for your input there. Okay, so how can students tackle their assignment writing? And Leslie, I think this might be another one for yourself.
I think for a lot of students that start at university, they've been to sixth form or they've been in school, they've come with whatever path, BTECs, A-levels, and they see this word, two words, academic writing, and they go into meltdown because they think it's something mysterious that only very academic people know. And I think for us, as support, we demystify it. It's only writing an assignment. It's not academic writing. It's small things, such as one of the big things is numbers 1 to 10, you write them down. Numbers 11 onwards, you can write the number, that type of thing. And it's just giving them hints and tips. And when we do these sessions, so many students say afterwards, oh, I feel so much better. It's just writing an essay, isn't it? Yes.
Yeah.
But getting it right, and obviously referencing ties into that, and it's always good to know that whatever books you read, whatever resources you look at, please make a note of them, because you'll spend 2 days or 3 days at the end trying to find whatever it is you've read to put in your references. So it's just about giving handy hints and tips, really, and demystifying that for students, because you can do it. You're at university, you've got here for a reason.
Yeah, and I think that's true for our adults. Adult students as well, particularly, you know, when they've been out of education for a while and it's sort of getting back into it. So I think that's why it's really important as early as you can. So as soon as you get that assignment brief, if you're not sure where to start, a really useful point is, you know, as well as your teachers, can I just say as well as us being a support team, you'll find that your lecturers and your tutors are all a fantastic resource as well. But make sure you kind of really understand what it is that it's asking, because I think sometimes that's where, you know, students can become unstuck, that I'm not quite sure what the question is asking. So with any assignment, make sure you've got that clarity, you know, and then you can obviously working with Leslie and the team to sort of build around that. But just to reassure our adult students, I think some of those workshops that we talked about that are online already just now and supplemented face to face, if you know, just a really good way of sort of building your confidence and getting back into the swing of things. But just as Leslie said, absolutely you can do it, and we're here to help.
There's loads of tools out there to help you as well. When I was doing my assignments last year, I was using the Site For Me website, which is really good. And then one of my colleagues told me that Word actually on their Word documents has like a cite button, and you can click that and it helps you reference all your work for you as well. So there's loads of online tools out there that give you a little bit of support as well.
Yeah, for sure. And I think another one is Seawheel, and there's Neil's Toolbox. There's quite a few out there, isn't there? I think that site for me is quite good. And I didn't realise either that Word did that. I wasn't aware. I think that must be that wasn't around when I was at uni.
No, it really wasn't. I'm glad it is now.
But no, loads of good things were raised there. You know, even like you said, breaking things down and making a note of if you've seen, you know, read a book or someone's mentioned a book, or if you're in a lecture and your tutor, you know, makes a reference to an author or, you know, a book, and it just kind of makes a fleeting note that they make, just make sure you write it down, because I'm sure you'll thank yourself later. Okay, so moving on. How can students get
additional? I was going to say, I think people struggle with their introduction as well. And they say, I don't know where to start. And I say, pick out your topics, few paragraphs. Your introduction can come at the end. You don't have to follow this format.
Yeah.
You can work your assignment however it works for you. Sorry, I did interrupt, but I think that's important as well.
No, when you've got an important point to make, Leslie, you can be forgiven. That's fine.
Okay.
No, but that is a great point. And, you know, you don't have to write, just because it's an introduction, don't write at the start. Once you've written your whole entire essay, that's when you'll know what you're introducing, because as well, you don't want to introduce an essay that doesn't actually talk about what you're going to write. And sometimes you only really know what you're going to write after you've written it. So even if you've written an introduction, it's always important to then revisit it as well, just to make sure that it does properly introduce, because you might have thought about, I'm going to talk about this, I'm going to cover this, and then maybe as you've gone through your essay, you've not actually covered some of them topics, or you've covered it a bit differently to how you said you was. So it's always best to make sure you obviously revisit that.
The other thing on that as well is, don't expect perfection first time. People want to write the most perfect, high-scoring, best assignment ever, don't they, on the first time. Like, make notes first, write a rough draft, edit it, play around with it, reframe it, put it in different orders. You don't expect your first draft to be the best version that you're going to submit. And that kind of goes back to your time management. You know, give yourself enough time to do drafts and edit it, and then rewrite it before you send it off.
Thanks for that, Chris. Okay, thanks everyone. So
and get someone else to read it for you.
Yeah.
No, sorry, it's me again. Get someone else to read it. You need a fresh pair of eyes on your assignment. Even if it's your mum, it's fine. Just get them to read it, because you do pick up things that you haven't seen because you've looked at it for too long and too much.
It's such a good point, that, Leslie. It's really, really, really so useful to do that.
Even your flatmate.
Fresh pair of eyes is always good.
Yeah.
Definitely. Okay, so how can students get additional support to meet their needs? So Annette, I think this might be one for you, and Bobby, I'm not sure if you might want to come in at some point as well.
Yeah, well, I think one of the things about the disability team is that, again, something that's, you know, echoed throughout everything that we've talked about is the sooner we know, the sooner we can help. So the first thing that I think students have to be aware of is that it really is different in terms of moving into higher education in terms of the support that's available. And if you, for example, have an EHCP, what you need to understand is that that's no longer carried over into higher education. And instead, any additional support that you're entitled to has to be assessed by the students. Student Finance England as part of the Disabled Student Allowance. So it's quite a robust process, and it does actually involve them coming out potentially to meet you to assess what your learning needs are. And then based on that, they will make an allocation of funding that will help you, you know, to make sure that you can cope with the demands of your course and that you're not in any way disadvantaged. But one thing to note is that that sits out with the university, particularly at UCEN Manchester. So it's something that, you know, as a student, you have to do sort of independently as soon as you possibly can. Now, even though we're saying independently, we know that it's asking for quite a lot of information. It's quite a big form to navigate. So between my team and Bobby's team, we are here to help. So no matter if you choose to come to UCEN Manchester, if you start that process and you become a bit unstuck, you can make contact with the Careers and Welfare team here, and we'll do our best to sort of help you along with that. But just to say that a lot of what you'll be entitled to will depend on that assessment, and that money, that support will go directly to you. It doesn't come to us. And then you will have the choice of some external providers on who you want to engage with. So based on their recommendations, you will then have to initiate that contact with that provider, provide them with your timetable, and then put the support in place. Whereas maybe just now what you're used to is that that conversation all happens behind the scenes and that there's someone in class to support you. So it is really different. So again, I think really, you know, the more you can do before you join your university of choice, the better. Now, once you're here, we'll be able to support you in different ways. We can help you with the transition, you know, help you to come onto campus, familiarise yourself with it, you know, so that your first day is not sort of freshers week, which can be, you know, really overwhelming. So we can help you sort of take that sort of staged approach to getting to know the campus, getting to know the staff, so that, you know, you feel really comfortable when it does come to your first day. And then in terms of the support out with of the Disabled Student Allowance, you know, that's part of like what Leslie's team do in terms of the study skills. We also have sort of student mentors that can sort of meet with you sort of one-to-one to offer that sort of pastoral support, more sort of guided support around sort of organizational skills, time management. So there's lots of support there, but I think one of the things is, you know, it's really personalized. You know, we really want it to be about the student and what you need. So the first thing that we'll do with in terms of the disability team is sit down with you and you tell us what works for you. What are the strategies that I've got here, got you here? And then what we can do is create what's called a personal learning plan, a PLP, and then sharing that information with us, we'll populate that and then share it with your lecturers. And that means you don't have to have the same conversation with, you know, with lots of different people. You can have that conversation with us, we'll share that, and then teach, you know, the tutors, the lecturers will know how to best meet your needs. So it's really starting that dialogue with you as soon as possible. We'll make sure all that support in place, but being really mindful, some of it will be external through the Disabled Student Allowance, and then some of it will be internal, so it will be a mixed model.
Just to reiterate what Annette said about the support that does come from Student Finance England, it's obviously external, it's not like before we're in Union College, and Student Finance England is for any student in England. So you can imagine each year it's 100,000 plus students going to university. So start your application early. Normally Student Finance England opens for applications in March. Now, if you're going to uni in September, you can start your application for DSA in March. That gives you time to prepare the evidence, submit the evidence for Student Finance England to do any assessments they need to do and let you know what you've been awarded. And that way you can have your support in place by the time you start your course in September. You don't want a situation where you apply late and you start your course without the support you need in place. And the support is wide and it's, you know, based on your specific needs. So it could be equipment like laptops, it could be money towards travel. So it's really broad. And, you know, if you did apply late or, you know, there's some missing evidence or something you couldn't get from a GP, for example, that would mean it would give you, it would put you at a disadvantage when you start in September. It could mean that the support arrives late and, you know, it could kind of impact your attendance, it could impact your ability to submit your work, and it could also impact the ability of, you know, teams like Annette's to put the personal learning plan in place as well, because they would need to see some of that information as well to put it in place. So I can't stress this enough, start the applications as early as possible so it can be assessed and be ready by the time you're ready to start your course.
Brilliant, thanks both. Raised a lot of important information there that I think people will find really useful. Okay, so just moving on to the next question, and this is about mental health. So how can students, you know, look after their mental health whilst they are at uni? You know, I mean, initially, you know, what would be the warning signs? Is anybody able to come in there?
I think the thing about it is that the same rules and principles of well-being apply. So it's really important that students eat well, that they don't, you know, overly consume on alcohol and drugs. That impacts significantly on your mental health. So making sure that you're also exercising. It's easy to, you know, maybe particularly I'm thinking about the weather right now, but it's easy to kind of lose sight of the things that we know that work in terms of keeping us, you know, mentally well. However, we do understand, particularly, we've just came out of a global pandemic, and we know, you know, young people, adults, we've all had, you know, a challenging time. So one of the things that we've invested in is a company called Palm Assist, that are available both online, so lots of different sort of, you know, fact sheets, modules to work through if that's how you like to learn about, you know, giving you more specific advice on sleep, on nutrition, on exercise, on mindfulness, lots, you know, all the different, all the things that are becoming more sort of common knowledge. But in addition to that, it also entitles you to sort of free counselling. So if you feel that actually you want to talk to someone, you can do that. So that's one of the things. We also have our own in-house counselling team, so that if you wanted to actually speak to someone on campus, you know, someone that was more sort of, you know, closer to the organisation, to UCEN Manchester, you can do that through a referral from what we refer to as a student support team. So they would be able to make a referral to the counselling team on your behalf. So it's trying to encourage students to not lose sight of all the things that we know that work, nutrition, you know, exercise, limiting alcohol and drugs. And then at the same time, you know, we do have that external support through Palm Assist and internal support through the student support team and the counselling team. So we do, and I think it's like Leslie was saying earlier, we do really take student wellbeing really seriously here at UCEN Manchester. And I think what one of the things that we really, you know, we think that makes us different from other universities is we'll notice if you're not attending. So we will follow up, you know, so other universities, it's, you know, it's up to you. We will follow up if your attendance starts to dip, to make sure that you're all right. And we also have a sort of an opt-in clause that if we were really concerned, we would have permission to contact like a family member, your next of kin, whoever your preferred contact was. So that if there was that sort of point of crisis, we would be able to sort of reach out to someone that you'd shared with us to, you know, offer that additional support.
And the other side of it as well is kind of like, you know, we call it the work-life balance, but it's more like the study-life balance, isn't it, when you're studying. There's a big social side to higher education as well, which some people, you know, don't really think about. just in UCEN, we have like our student union, so there's lots of different groups that you can join. You can be a paid student ambassador as well, so you can get involved in running like events with the careers team, with the student unions, with recruitment teams as well. You can go into some schools and like deliver activities, or do like IEG stands and show people around the campus. In Manchester, I just absolutely love living in Manchester because 45 minutes that way, you've got the Peak District for like hiking and climbing mountains and rock climbing. In the city centre, you've got this big like arts and theatre sort of scene going on. There's bars, there's clubs as well. There's like really cool restaurants. You can join stuff like Meetup, where if you don't know about Meetup, it's this really good app where you get to meet other people with similar interests on there. You have everything from like knitting groups to cinema clubs to, I don't know, walking clubs and stuff like that. There's just so much going on all the time, and it's really good to get involved with a student union and get them to set up clubs with you and on your behalf. But also look at all the different opportunities that are just in and around Manchester. There's just so much going on.
That's brilliant. I didn't even know about that app, Meetup, Chris. I think it's just things like that that, you know, if people are struggling, because sometimes, you know, there's obviously loads of different reasons that people might be struggling with their mental health, but sometimes just, you know, a bit of social interaction really, really can help. And it does come down to, you know, anything that you've mentioned yourself there, or even what we mentioned earlier on about, you know, studying together with like your colleagues, your classmates. And just a bit of social interaction can sometimes just help be that little pickup that you need. You know, you might still be studying, or, you know, or even if you manage to get out and join one of these meetups, it's just that social interaction, and it will just help pick you up and just maybe give you a bit of a different view on things, and just take your mind off things as well. And just that little bit of social interaction, it really does go a long way. So that was a really great point. Thanks for that, Chris.
I think momentum creates motivation. I remember a couple of years ago, I thought I need to do a little bit more of exercise. I thought I'll go running. I used to like running when I was a little bit younger. And one of the big things in running is the park runs, where you can go to your local park and there's these organized run events, and you do a 5K run or walk if you want to. And I went down to this thing and I did my first 5K run, but it was more like walking. And I got to the end and I like really struggling to breathe. And I thought, this is hard work. But I was kind of motivated by all the other people there. So I went back again and then went back again. And after a couple of months, I was able to run around without struggling to breathe. And then a couple months later, I was running quite fast, and I started meeting friends there, and there was groups I was running. From there, though, I started doing like 5K races, and then 10K races, and then 10-mile races, and then I started doing like half marathons. And I do half marathon trail runs now, because going to a social event and getting motivated by 300 people running with you around the park, when your heart's pounding and you can't breathe, that momentum created motivation for me. So go out, find these clubs, find things that you're interested in, get other people to motivate you. And you can even link it to your assignments. If you're studying history, join a history group. If you're doing arts, join some sort of cultural arts scene. There's loads of things that you can do for your personal interest, or something that will give you a social side, but will link to your studies as well.
Amazing. Great. Thanks for that. Okay. So finally, I just wanted to see if anybody's got any final tips that they would like to mention. You may have already brought it up and you want to reiterate it, or if there's just anything that you might not have mentioned already. So is there anything anyone else wants to add?
I would like to say, don't feel like you're the only one. It's easy to think everyone knows what they're doing. It's only you who struggles with essays and assignments and deadlines. Everyone else has got everything perfectly done on time and you're the last one doing it, finishing it, you know, a few hours before the deadline. You might think that everyone else has got friends here and it's just me who's alone, I'm doing something wrong. That's not the case. More than likely, most people feel exactly like you and you're all going through very similar things. So don't feel like you're alone in that sense, and don't let it hold you back. Don't let it stop you going forward. There's a good chance that everyone you're starting your course with doesn't know each other. It's highly unlikely that you all kind of join from the same school or the same college. So you're all starting from the same point. So don't feel that it's just you. So talk to people. You're going to find that they're going to be saying a lot of the same things, and get involved. If you're in a group of people, believe me, they're just as nervous as you are. They're just probably as shy as you are. So don't feel like you're the odd one out trying to fit in. The truth is, everyone feels the exact same way. So don't let it hold you back.
Amazing.
I know this has been picked up in some of the other webinars we've done, but I think for me, it's about choosing the right subject, you know, something that you're really passionate about, not necessarily worrying where it's going to take you to, because I think most employers, it's the fact, you know, it's the fact you have a degree and that you've shown that commitment that matters, less so than the subject. So for me, it's making sure that you pick something that you're really, really passionate about, that you're really going to enjoy, because it's such a luxury to have sort of 3 years where that's all you have to think about, to really explore that subject, to get under the, you know, the bones of it. It's just fantastic. And then I think that just opens it up to meeting people that share that same passion, the friendships that you will form. So for me, it's about making sure that you pick the right course, you pick the right university. So making sure that you take advantage of all the different open days, all the different taster events, just to really make sure that you pick some place where you feel that you belong and that you have a fantastic 3 years exploring that degree.
Brilliant. Thanks for that, Annette. Okay, so I'd last just like to thank you all for taking part tonight. I mean, each and every one of you have just given some really, really useful and insightful advice and nuggets of information. And it's just been really, really interesting. And I hope that's, you know, people watching, whether they're watching live now or if they're watching it, going to be watching it back, will just be able to take some of that useful information away. And I hope it really resonates with them. But yeah, so thank you very much for joining us, and from us it's a goodbye. But yeah, thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.